Thank you everyone for showing up in this nice, bright, sunny day. I'm Rick Wilson, Director of Scientia, and I'd like to thank you for attending today's final Scientia lecture this academic year on the topic of privacy. So as you know, we live in an age where little of what we do is kept private. Just ask the ex-governor of Alabama. When we surf the web, the sites we visit, how long we view, and what we click or log and use for commercial purposes, and sometimes non-commercial purposes, depending on where we live, our movement throughout the day is tracked by GPS and countless other surveillance cameras. Basically, you might wonder, where is privacy? Well, today we're fortunate to have Kirsten Oster, a professor in the Department of English and fellow at the John P. McGovern Center for Humanities and Ethics at the UT Health Science Center, speaking to us. Her topic is that, and should point to the lack of privacy, I suspect, just in the devices we carry with us. Professor Oster earned her PhD from Brown University in 2001, and in 2014 earned her master's in public health from the UT School of Public Health. She joined Rice in 2002. Let's see. Oh, and has been associate director of Scientia since 2014. She's a co-founder and director of the Medical Futures Lab that brings together faculty from Rice, Baylor College of Medicine, and UT Health. She's authored numerous articles, and several books, including the 2013 book entitled Medical Visions, Producing the Patient Through Film, Television, and Imaging Technologies, published by Oxford University Press. She's won numerous awards, including a Mellon Foundation New Foundations Fellowship in 2012, which enabled her to earn her master's in public health. Without further ado, I'm looking forward to this talk. I'll turn it over to Kirsten.
Okay, thank you all so much for coming, especially on this dark and rainy day. I'm delighted to have the opportunity to talk about this topic here, which is one that I've been doing research on for several years now. It really started while I was doing the MPH degree, and I got really interested in mobile health technologies and the promise that they seemed to offer, but also the skepticism that they were met with in many quarters. And I've become really interested in how these technologies intersect with the ways that we use other kinds of technologies in other parts of our lives. So I think you'll see some of that in the discussion today. So what I want to do, I'm going to give kind of an overview that situates some of this work broadly. And then I'm going to talk about a couple of key concepts, autonomy and the concept of health datafication in user-generated culture, and also privacy as a flexible cultural artifact. And then I'll wrap up by talking about what all of that means for human subjects, for the concept of human subjects in the domain of data science research. So, and I want to say actually before starting that some of this work is based on research that I did with a group of graduate students. It was enabled by a Mellon seminar through the Humanities Research Center, which was a year-long graduate seminar that took place last academic year, with five students, Rachel Racken from the English department, Brandon Williams from the philosophy department, and then Svetlana Borodina, Charlie Lauterman, and Elliot Storer from anthropology. We worked together on this topic over the course of a year. We did a bunch of interviews with people out in the community, data science researchers, members of the general public, and founders of health information technology startups. And on the basis of that research, wrote an article which is on this topic, which will be coming out in the journal Big Data and Society in the next couple of weeks. So kudos to them for the excellent work that they did, and I'm really pleased to be able to present this material now today. Okay, so I think all of you probably know, even though you may not think of it always in these terms, that members of the general public, including you, but also including patients, have begun to play a newly important role in collecting data about health and disease in recent years. With the rise of the mobile web, of course, and the growth of smartphone use, our daily lives have really become experiments in the wild, in a sense. And the digital traces that we produce as we move around the world offer both new opportunities and new challenges to researchers who are interested in gathering information about human exposures and human behaviors outside of clinical settings, so outside of laboratories, which is where that kind of data had previously been gathered. So things like these, step counters, continuous heart rate monitors, sleep trackers, calorie counters, other kinds of activity trackers, those are popular features of wearable devices that are readily available now at places like Target and on Amazon and that sort of thing. But it wasn't that long ago that you had to go to a kind of cutting edge health technology conference to see these things demoed. Now they're a pretty normal part of our day-to-day lives, but maybe even, certainly 10 years ago, that was not the case, and I would say probably 5 years ago was only starting to be the case. Now, unlike the devices that I just showed you that kind of track things like steps and stuff that may not be that relevant to health, really, maybe are more kind of wellness sorts of devices, there are also devices out there like AliveCore, which go a step further and actually go through the rigorous process of getting FDA approval. And once they do that, they can be covered by insurance and they can be prescribed by physicians. And what this device does is it is a mobile electrocardiogram, basically. So it's really useful for people with heart disease, people at risk of stroke, and you can diagnose remotely and get that data sent to a doctor. So this is kind of a far end of the spectrum of the kinds of wearable devices that are out there being used in health and medicine in terms of its direct relevance to and accessibility to doctors in the doctor-patient relationship. So this kind of stuff, I think, begins to show the true potential of mobile health technologies that offer the kinds of monitoring and feedback that really previously had only been available in hospitals or in clinical settings. By bringing those capabilities outside of the clinic, patients can access them where they live, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And so these kinds of devices suggest the possibility for really radically transforming what we mean by the doctor-patient relationship or what we mean by healthcare even. And it suggests that people's health may be improved by these devices in a way that could lead to something like more preventative medicine rather than only reactive medicine, which is mainly what we have now. So on the individual level, that seems like that could be really great and very promising and helpful for people who are kind of at risk for the conditions that a device like that might help with. But the global context, I think, complicates the picture a fair bit. This is a map of mobile connectivity by region from January of this year. And you know, one thing you can see on this is that several parts of the world have more than 100% mobile connectivity, which just means that people there are people there who have more than one registered sort of connection to the web, basically. And the part of the world that has the lowest connectivity in Africa is still 81%. So you can see that there is a huge amount of mobile connectivity to the internet around the world. And the thing about that is that, of course, everyone, as they connect to the internet, are constantly leaving these digital footprints all over the place that leave traces of everything that they do, ranging from shopping to banking to entertainment, or to uploading their Fitbit data and that kind of thing. And so this creates the conditions of possibility for increased datafication, which is something I'll talk about in a little bit. Now, all those devices that connect to that web that are both part of the wearable tech world, but also part of what is broadly, was first called the Internet of Things, then the Internet of Everything, now they seem to have actually just sort of vanished into the fabric of our lives, and they're just sort of part of life in advanced capitalism, it seems. They're not even called anything anymore. But in a short period of time, descriptions of the Internet of Things seemed very futuristic at first, and there were products that were being advertised that seemed kind of implausible and not necessary, like talking refrigerators or smart coffee makers, those sorts of things. It all seemed a little bit implausible, but it has become so pervasive that it was the foundation for this huge distributed denial of service attack last October. I'm sure people, if you didn't hear about it in these terms, you heard about this phenomenon which occurred, which was basically that a huge network of internet service providers on the East Coast crashed multiple times over the course of a day. I think it might have even spanned more than one day. And it was through attacks on smart connected devices, like televisions or DVRs or air conditioners. It could be any kind of connected device. And those were used to mount an attack that brought down this huge infrastructure. So this was a really big wake-up call to a lot of people who, when they thought about privacy and security and trust before that, were not really thinking about, you know, getting Netflix on their TV and how that might put them at risk. They were thinking about maybe their banking, right? But this exposed a different dimension of that. And of course, these connected devices don't only create vulnerabilities from hackers, but they also create new opportunities for surveillance. And this was kind of a remarkable headline on this topic just a couple of weeks ago, where WikiLeaks released a lot of documents that suggested that in the US and the UK, that government surveillance was using things like smart TVs to spy on people, because they have cameras in them. So, and as if all that weren't enough, just a couple days ago, some fairly significant consumer privacy law that had been enacted last fall was overturned, which was supposed to give consumers protection about how their data that was collected by internet service providers was used, shared, sold, etc. And that was supposed to at least sort of constrain the largest funnel of the data that we produce, because whether you're doing it on Facebook or on Google or wherever, it all goes there through an internet service provider. So if they have the capacity to share data at will or sell it at will or whatever, they have everything essentially. So so those protections were just rolled back a couple of days ago. So that's the kind of larger context for what I'm going to talk about for the rest of the talk here. So in going back to then the health technologies in particular, we've had a kind of truism emerge from the development of wearable health technologies and the potential that they seem to offer for gathering new kinds of data and doing new kinds of research, which is this truism that more data equals more knowledge, which will lead to better health outcomes. And I want to question that formula in part, not only because there are questions to raise about whether data equals knowledge, but also because there's a larger question about how we understand better health outcomes and what kinds of assumptions are embedded in that equation. Another way of asking that question is to ask what new kinds of knowledge, if there are new insights gained from this data, what the new knowledge might reveal, and for whom might they improve outcomes. So in other words, is this a benefit to individual patients? Is it a benefit to insurance companies? Is it a benefit to the government? Who is it a benefit for, and at what cost? So in this context, I think the question of who benefits from big health data is really entangled with questions about data ownership, about sharing and trust in who you share that data with, and larger ideas about privacy. And so I'm going to explore those ideas in what follows, and talk about them in relation to some of these kind of emerging concepts and contradictions that I'm seeing in this field. So the next part of this talk is on autonomy and the concept of health datafication in user-generated culture. Okay, so user-generated content is a term that started being used by marketers in particular, but also by other people who do things on the web in the early 2000s. And user-generated content is really one of the key features of the kinds of wearable technologies I'm talking about. Because, so if you think about something like Facebook, right? Facebook itself, it's just a platform. All of the content on Facebook is produced by the users. Okay? If people didn't post things on Facebook, Facebook would be nothing. So it connects people, it does all these things with that, with the content they put up there, but the content is produced by users. This has been spun into all different kinds of strategies for selling things like this one. So this is Starbucks Instagram feed. And Starbucks, like many companies, do things like say, you know, like you will get a discount on your next cup of coffee if you post a picture of yourself having a cup of coffee somewhere. And then they have this whole Instagram feed and people, and it's an incentive. I'm sure all of you have gotten these offers before. Maybe some of you have taken them up, and it's, you know, it's kind of an appealing thing to do because there's some incentive that's offered to you. But what this has then produced is all of these different domains where people are producing user-generated content. So it comes from regular people. This is one of the ways that some people think that the internet is a kind of democratizing force in the sense that anyone can post content on the internet, right? So whether that's exploited for other purposes is sort of another question. But user-generated content early on started to pique the interest of health researchers who realized that actually this kind of content might be useful for health research as well, even if it wasn't about health data per se. That where people go, which you can get from GPS, and the kinds of things that they purchase or the things that they do in those places or how active they are, all of those things could actually give you really interesting information that is about, say, the environmental or social dimensions of health. So quickly, user-generated content became an area of interest for health researchers. But in addition to that, the growing popularity of wearable health and wellness trackers like the Fitbit or the Jawbone app or the Apple Watch or others created what I'm calling today an abundance of user-generated health data. So it's kind of a particular variant of user-generated content. Like the incidental health data that's derived from GPS or from social media, user-generated health data are produced, shared, and exploited under very poorly defined privacy and ownership policies. So for example, the terms of use for most wearable technology stipulates that the company can sell your data, which depending on how you look at it, you might actually consider it to be your data, but they see it as their data. They can sell it to third parties as they see fit in the course of business deals. And you know, you might think, well, why does it matter what companies do with this kind of data? But this was an early story, this was from 2012, that first started to alert people to the concerns that might come out of the ways that data, like your shopping habits, might reveal things about you that you didn't want revealed. So the headline pretty much says it all, the girl shopping habits led Target to believe she was pregnant. They started sending her coupons for diapers and formula and all this stuff, and those were going to her house. Her parents didn't know she was pregnant. So there are now many more stories of this kind of thing where wearable technologies are sort of telling stories on behalf of the people who are wearing them that were not necessarily the stories that those people expected to be told or wanted to be told or wanted perhaps to be told in public. So as of about a year ago, 1 in 6 US adults owned a smartwatch or fitness tracker. How many people in here own or have owned at any time a smartwatch or fitness tracker? Okay, but how many people in here own a smartphone? Okay. That was everyone for people who can turn around. So 1 in 6 owns a smartwatch or fitness tracker, whether or not they wear it. That meant that about a year ago, at least 40 million people in this country were counting their steps, checking their heart rate, and tracking other kinds of data. And the wearables market is already a multi-billion dollar industry, and it's growing every year. So this is another one of these stories. Fitbit told a couple they were going to have a baby. This was another one where a Fitbit told, it captured the moment that a man's heart broke, as he called it, where he got broken up with by text in a very 21st century kind of move. But the thing is that all of these stories, although these are kind of the catchy stories that make headlines, all of these activities that are captured through these wearables and other kinds of devices that we have on us all the time, they're really reshaping our understanding of selfhood and social relationships and human behavior, in particular as it relates to health. And they're really redefining sort of what we consider to be the sources of information about all those things that we prioritize. So this is where, based on the graph here, the man said his Fitbit captured the exact moment he felt heartbreak. Okay. So there's the consumer-facing part of wearable health devices. But there's a larger context that all this is feeding into, which I've already mentioned, which is health research. And in 2015, the Precision Medicine Initiative, a major, major new initiative from the NIH and many other agencies in the US government, was launched. And this is a massive undertaking that is totally premised on the idea of wearable health trackers and the information that they can give us and how it can change our understanding of health and disease in a sort of longitudinal and latitudinal sense. So it's supposed to be, there's supposed to be a million person cohort. It's supposed to represent all people in all diverse walks of life across the United States. They're supposed to be tracked for at least 10 years, and they're supposed to donate their data ranging from perhaps their personal genome to anything that they're tracking on devices of any kind, as well as any other information related to their medical records, their health records. So in the context of that kind of initiative, patients and consumers really are going to play an important role in that undertaking for it to actually work. And so given that, the need for clarity around the role of user-generated health data in both commercial and scientific enterprises, I think, is fairly pressing. So when the PMI was launched in the United States in 2015, the Precision Medicine Initiative, it was described as a new way of doing research that fosters open, responsible data sharing with the highest regard to participant privacy and that puts engaged participants at the center of research efforts. So the idea is engaging regular people to donate their data is how this cohort is going to yield health insights. This whole idea of open, responsible data sharing really rests on the assumption that future uses of these data sets would not produce harmful, unintended consequences for the data donors. But legal scholars and data scientists have shown that data privacy is virtually impossible to ensure. On top of that, we actually don't know much about how and why participants engage in data sharing, what privacy means to those participants in the health context, and what individuals think that researchers and businesses can and should do with their data, nor do we really know what the users think they might gain or lose by sharing their data beyond their personal social networks. So that's to say, there are a lot of really big questions that are unanswered that have to be answered for this to go forward. So to kind of provide a little bit of context as I go into this in a little more detail, there are a couple terms that we defined in our research that I think are relevant for the talk today. One of them is user-generated health data, which I already was talking about in the context of user-generated content. We distinguish between this type of data, which is captured through devices or software in some way. Those devices and software could be purpose-built or commercially available. Importantly, they're used outside of traditional clinical settings. They track personal health data in some way, and they're like the things I've been talking about, wearable, heart rate monitors, etc. So this user-generated health data is distinct from the kind of data you would capture in a randomized controlled trial that takes place in a lab. It's in the wild, and that distinction is really important. The other key concept is medical context. We think of that in terms of sort of traditional clinical settings, so doctors' offices, hospitals. Importantly, these are places where doctor-patient interaction is governed by particular kinds of policies, like the Health Information Portability and Accountability Act, which is known as HIPAA, as well as devices that have to go through this process of FDA approval. So you can't just start using random devices in hospital settings without them having all of these kind of assurances about their safety and efficacy and that sort of thing. So those two distinctions are really important because of the ways that wearable health technologies move medical care outside of traditional clinical settings, and in so doing, generate different kinds of data that then are subject to sort of unknown policies around trust and privacy and that kind of thing. So In 2014, now 3 years ago, Cellular One. This is anyone a Cellular One subscriber here? I wonder if anyone happened to get this. Okay, so this company started offering Texas and Louisiana customers mobile video-based access to doctors for $30 a visit. And what was really fascinating to me about that is that they put it directly on your phone bill. It didn't go to insurance. It went through telecommunications. So it was an early demonstration of the ways that actually telecommunications companies are really kind of moving into the healthcare domain, and they are some of the players that are really invested in this redefinition of the clinic as being something that's outside of these traditional settings and that has that have business models that are very much premised on utilizing the data that is created in these exchanges for their profit. So this approach has really kind of generated a lot of steam and momentum. So there are a lot of digital health startups that are capitalizing on the idea of kind of moving healthcare onto the clinic through using software and devices and services that work around in some way the traditional brick and mortar doctor's office or hospital. So First Line has this doctor on demand app. Some people called it the Uber for healthcare. Ostherr is a kind of reimagining of health insurance. It's mainly based in Manhattan. And one of the things that this promotional material and the promotional material for a lot of these kinds of devices does is they try to bring together technology and the idea of humanizing, rehumanizing healthcare. So oftentimes the premise is traditional healthcare has become so inhumane that the only way to actually make medicine human again is by bringing it outside of those settings and delivering it to you through some kind of technology that's designed to give you a human experience. And that's sort of the rhetoric that you see in a lot of the advertising for a lot of these devices. One of the features of this sort of rhetorical argument, and you can see it in the tagline here, skip the urgent care, doctors are making house calls again. There's kind of this idea that people would, if they can't afford it, would prefer to avoid not just hospitals, but emergency rooms and all the people who can't afford to go anywhere else, right? There's this implicit, here's another one with the line, see a doctor now without leaving home. The advertising copy suggests that it's so much better to see a doctor without encountering all of the other sick people who have no choice but to go to an ER to receive basic healthcare. And this prompted some critics to call these kinds of startups on-demand healthcare for the 1%. So, you know, it's the idea that this is really kind of a bifurcated model of providing access to care that totally depends on whether or not people have access to the resources to pay. So this raises a really fundamental question around digital health technologies, is whether these wearable devices democratize access to care or exacerbate health disparities, or perhaps both. So although the blurring of the lines between the clinical and the non-clinical, or between medical and health and wellness domains, might seem to suggest that these distinctions are becoming less relevant, I think that you can actually see that the existing rules that define what can and cannot happen in different spaces and who will pay for it is still really, really relevant to what goes on in these different settings, who has access to these things, what kinds of benefits they can actually derive from these wearable technologies, and whether or not ultimately then this leads to a kind of democratization of care because people can get these things just at Target, say, and for relatively cheaply compared to going to a hospital or not. And so there's an interesting tension between the clinical and the non-clinical, those boundaries becoming kind of less and less relevant and yet becoming remaining very relevant because of the regulations around them that haven't gone away. Much of it has to do with insurance. So the emergence of user-generated health data as distinct from clinical health data is, as I've suggested, part of this larger zeitgeist of user-generated culture, which has captured the attention of a lot of individuals and corporations and hospitals, governments within the past decade, and you know, the companies like Uber and Airbnb and Facebook, they're all part of this. So in the health domain, these user-generated practices have generated new types of health data that, like I've suggested, avoid many of the infrastructures and actors that are traditionally involved in healthcare and health decision making. And as improved methods for collecting and processing and storing large data sets are developed, the big health data that is generated by individual patients may really redefine our conceptions of health, disease, and what it means to be a patient. We're getting much more data than we ever used to get because people used to only produce data when they went to a clinical setting. Now the clinical setting is the entire world, and people are producing that data all day, every day. And this is a screenshot from one patient community online that is trying to gain insights from the data that the other patients with Crohn's disease, for example, put onto the website and share with each other about medication side effects, dietary strategies, and other things like that. So it's important, though, to remember that the practices surrounding user-generated health data don't just convey information. The data is not just information. These practices also mediate medical knowledge, and they help to construct a meaning that bridges health and medical domains, or wellness and medical domains. And these practices of mediation provide a really important context for understanding what contemporary scholars have called datafication. It's not just putting, it's not just capturing data about things. One of the first people to use this term in 2013 described datafication as the effect of individual actions, sensory data, and other real-world measurements creating a digital image of our reality. So that's a sort of slightly more abstract version of the way this term is used right now, but the idea is that it's a process of kind of trying to recapture in data form the experiences of everyday life, many of which may not be that amenable to capturing in the form of data. Another definition of this term from a couple years later is the process of rendering into data aspects of the world not previously quantified, including behavioral metadata. So places you go and things that you do while you're doing other things. In that first definition of it by Cookier, he draws some, he provides some examples like Facebook datafies friendships, Twitter datafies whispers or stray thoughts, LinkedIn datafies professional contacts. You can kind of keep going with that for the other sorts of digital startups that have emerged in these in days since then. So practices of datafication transform existing data into, they transform phenomena in the world into data and then make that into something that could become actionable in ways that it might not have been before it had been converted into data. So that process then produces new forms of value. So that's why the concept of datafication is really interesting to a lot of scholars, because it's a process for sometimes monetizing things and sometimes for being able to kind of quantify things that by enacting that process of quantification can become measurable in ways that they hadn't been measurable before. And sometimes people see that as beneficial and sometimes they don't, and they see that as threatening and more like a type of surveillance. So right now, contemporary practices of health datafication occur both within and beyond clinical settings. And this poses some challenges to traditional understandings of agency and ownership of medical data. So for instance, in most states, it actually hospitals own your electronic medical record. You don't. A lot of people are surprised by that, but it's true. And so you can ask for your access to all of that data, but like in legal terms, they own it. So, you know, if you generate the data outside of the clinical setting, then you own it. Except you think you own it, but actually the company that owns the device also thinks they own it. So this is what I mean by the privacy and the privacy policies around these phenomena are very messy. They're very poorly understood. They're poorly defined. So this gets us to this idea of privacy as a flexible cultural artifact. Okay. So there's a social movement called the quantified self. This started long before you could get a Fitbit at Target, and it started in the Bay Area, of course. And it was people who, it was mostly started by people who had some kind of health condition that traditional medicine had failed to define or diagnose for them or treat in any adequate way. And they started to just try to use their own ability to observe phenomena in their body and note it down and then track it over time to try to diagnose themselves, basically. So this group called themselves Quantified Self, and their tagline is self-knowledge through numbers, right? So they aimed to employ wearables, mobile devices, apps, anything that they could to capture data to decode health problems on their own as sort of N of one studies. But they really embraced the core philosophy of big data. In doing so, they raised really interesting questions, I think, about what it means to quantify the self. What is a self that is quantified? And how does that actually, what is that self in a medical context? How do you actually act on that as a body when you're talking about very different data sets that are captured in very different settings, but that are supposed to all amount to a more coherent picture of one single individual? So, part of the challenge in this new world of data, health datafication, is that notwithstanding a lot of the hype around the Apple Watch, which actually did develop some apps that could push data to patients' electronic medical records, that they developed these with specific hospitals like the Cedars Mount Sinai, for instance, in Los Angeles. Apart from that, most of the data from these wearable devices actually cannot be pushed to an electronic health record. So there are specific cases where a doctor could say to you, I will create a space in your EHR where you can send information, but they have no way to integrate that into anything else and actually do anything with it. So these two domains are really functionally completely separate, and for the purposes of care of any kind of action, the wearable health data is essentially invisible to any encounter with a traditional healthcare provider in a traditional medical setting. And furthermore, although in a kind of offhand way, a provider could sort of prescribe, like, oh, why don't you get a Fitbit and make sure you walk, you know, get 10,000 steps a day or something like that, they can't really prescribe other kinds of devices in the way that they typically prescribe things and have insurance pay for it, unless those are devices that are considered to be medical devices and gone through FDA approval and all that. So on the one hand, we have all this rhetoric about the breakdown between these two domains and the ways that health data is going to kind of move across them and give us a richer picture of people and their lives and their environments and exposures and all those things. But at the level of policy, these things are actually very, very separated, and it's very hard for them to cross over into each other's domains. And this becomes very clear when you start to actually look at the terms and conditions for these kinds of devices, which many of us use, but none of us read these terms and conditions. And so, interestingly, if you are in a hospital or if you're participating in a study, there are actually a huge number of protections on your data, on the collection of the data, on how it can be used, who can have access to it, where it should be stored, all these things. But outside of clinical settings, there are hardly any. And the only place where those protections, if you want to call it that, really exist are in the terms and conditions, of the terms of use for these different products. So people agree. They have to agree to terms and conditions in order to use any of these devices. So any of you who do have a wearable device, when you started it up, you clicked through these, and of course you did just click through them and didn't read them, because maybe 20% of the population reads at least some part of these things, but I'm not convinced that even that 20% reads all of it. But what you would find if you did read it was wording that permits the parent company to sell your data to third parties, including marketers and advertisers and all kinds of other data brokers. And while the users who generate health data outside of clinical settings may be vulnerable to third-party exploitation, many still see self-tracking tools that put health measurement and quantification into the user's hands as a democratizing force that challenges what had previously been a very paternalistic doctor-patient knowledge hierarchy, where the doctor had all the knowledge and information and the patient really had none. So the rhetoric of democratization as enacted through these devices is very powerful. And I captured some of the terms and conditions from a live core here. I don't expect you to be able to read that, of course. I guess people don't want to read it anyway. But you know, if you start to drill down into this stuff, you know, there are variations, but all of these companies reserve the right to work with third parties to do all kinds of things with your data, and that's their business model. So the activists who are part of the quantified self movement, they see the democratizing potential of this kind of stuff, and they embrace it. And so they really, for those groups, the term health datafication, with the kind of negative connotations that I've been describing, they prefer to see this process as something that is called health data making. So the idea that there's a kind of agency in taking control over understanding and producing your own data. So there's a lot of language that's about the agency that comes from possessing and generating your own data. Even if it kind of has to stay outside of the traditional clinical realm, which is where all of the value is supposed to come from. However, at the same time, those same participants often are very concerned about what would happen to their data if they participate in clinical trials. And so I'm going to get to that as I start to wrap up the talk. I think this is sort of paradoxical, but maybe not surprising, which is that a lot of users are more willing to share their health data on an app than they are to speak honestly with their healthcare providers. A lot of people like to gather in these group settings that are sponsored by Fitbit and other kinds of device manufacturers to have a social experience that includes sharing their data with other people online and then having a kind of somewhat gamified competitive thing going on online that they then also bring into their real world experiences. So the appeal of doing that and of having those kinds of social experiences trumps concern over what might be done with that data and what the kinds of corporations, what their ultimate goals are for these kinds of business deals. So there's sort of a contradiction here where in traditional medical context, user-generated data sharing is very restricted, though the feedback loop between the user and the MD is quite high. I mean, that's the whole point of your interaction there. Outside of medical context, user-generated data sharing is quite permissive and open, but the feedback between the user's data and then the MD is very low. That's like, there is no feedback loop. It is not a closed circle. So some of the people that we talked to when we were doing research on this commented directly on a phenomenon that I think a lot of people are familiar with, which is that, you know, when you feel like you want to use a product, you just agree to the terms of use. Because it's kind of either you do or you don't. You don't get to kind of negotiate that process. So this was one of the quotes that I think kind of summed it up, and I like that they even acknowledged that they had not even read the consent form that they just signed to participate in the research that we were doing with them. It's kind of a typical phenomenon. The Internet Society did a survey of 10,000 people back in 2012 on this same topic and found, not surprisingly, that most people don't read privacy policies, and they blame the length of the document or the complexity of it, or just their sense that they have no agency in this process, because if they want to use a device or software, they have to just agree, and that's it. All right, so moving to the conclusion here. So various scholars, Nicholas Rose, very eminently in recent years, have argued that health and biological vitalities are really major analytics for governing individuals and populations in contemporary states. And in the context of states that have decreasing welfare provisions, for example, and really strong emphasis on personal autonomy and independence, the idea of resilient health and vitality as something that is an individual responsibility and choice is something that has really become a very prominent form of representing what health is and whose responsibility it is. So instead of addressing larger conditions that produce things like toxic environments or systemic poverty or inadequate social resources, these contemporary discourses of corporate and state care really cultivate the idea that health and healthcare is primarily an individual concern and responsibility. And so you can see that self-driving devices can very easily be understood in this context especially given that they operate outside of health insurance networks primarily, that they really don't actually interact directly with the medical settings, et cetera. And yet they're promoted as something that is empowering. It's empowering you to take control over your own healthcare. These critics would suggest that that so-called empowerment is actually not an empowerment at all. Okay, but again, the same kind of connective capabilities that make your data available for all kinds of exploitation also do create the opportunity for alternative data making practices. So in addition to the chronology site I showed you, the site Patients Like Me, which covers a lot of different diseases, where again, patients input their own data, they have developed pretty elaborate systems for trying to make that data that's captured in the wild useful for research. And in fact, Walgreens started posting the patient-generated data on some of their websites so that you could compare the side effects to a medication that you might have just been prescribed to those of regular people who used it, not to the results of a randomized controlled trial. So it's a very different model of what medical knowledge and information might actually be. So there are competing ideas too about whether health datafication or health data making actually is something that could still democratize medicine, even though it's happening in this context where there are a lot of tensions around the question of agency and control and who shares their data and with whom. So one of the surprising results of our interviews, to wrap up here, was that despite the fact that they were happening in the context of nearly constant reporting on large-scale data breaches around the world, the people we talked to expressed almost no concern about sharing their data or what would be done with it. They seemed to feel that, you know, if they wanted to use the software, the device, that this was what they had to do, and that was it. Just as a sidebar, this website information is beautiful. It's a guy who's like a data visualization guy. This is an interactive visualization of all of the large scale data breaches around the world over time. And you can click on them to see kind of how many users were affected and what the context was. It's a fascinating site. In the context of these large data breaches, you might think people would sort of retrench and say they don't want to share as much. But in fact, social sharing is just growing, growing, growing. There's no reason to think that that's going to end anytime soon. The question is whether the idea that you have to just trade your ability to control access to your data completely in order to participate in that ecosystem is, I think, what's really at question. So the idea that it's impossible to opt out of surveillance practices, I think, is one that really needs to be scrutinized further, especially because oftentimes the ways that these data are used reproduce kinds of human biases and that can lead to real harms and have done so in settings outside of healthcare and that may easily lead to the same thing inside of healthcare. So although patients find doing things like finding other patients on Twitter and communicating with them and sharing data as a really, really valuable thing to do, and they don't want that shut down in any way, their sense that this network is highly personal to them and is therefore really valuable operates at the same time as this sense that the algorithms and the other forces that are making decisions about what to do with the data they're producing could actually be used against them in all kinds of ways when people are talking about their health vulnerabilities, say, online. So I want to just wrap by saying when the people that we talked about participating in scientific research, they were very reticent to do so. And one of the things that we found was that actually the more that you foreground what's happening when someone consents to share their data, the less people wanted to do it, right? So we found that actually, in a way, the consent process was like a process of narrating all the terrible things that you were going to do with their data in order to say you weren't going to do that. And I think this is very suggestive in thinking about ways that we might reimagine the problem of the kind of all or nothing data sharing that's going on in the social sharing of health data without concern as to how the data is going to be used. So in this context, the concept of privacy is very fluid and social and contextual. It doesn't just mean one thing in one time. It's changing often, and it depends a lot on the social network that a person is defining it inside of. It is defined in within competing discourses. One is a discourse of threat around data piracy, security leaks, hackers, malevolent hackers, and on the other hand, a discourse of benefit, participatory culture, social sharing, open data. So the last point that I'm just going to close with is that we have seen how, for example, using artificial intelligence to try to improve things like community policing, this is an example from a story that ProPublica did in Chicago, actually reproduces the same racial biases of the people that develop the algorithms and ultimately end up racially profiling people who do not commit crimes and not catching people who do commit crimes. It's very easy to imagine how the same kinds of things could happen in the context of healthcare, and that's why we need to have a much more robust public discussion around all of this stuff, despite the complexity of the dialogue that I hope to have laid out for you. Thank you.
Questions?
Thank you. That was very interesting and scary. But you touched on this a little bit towards the end with the Walgreens example. But what I found was kind of striking was, you know, there's this notion of using all this data, your own data, for personalized medicine. But by definition, in a sense, when you're comparing with this rich data set that's coming up for free from everybody, you're averaging. And so you're sort of going against, the here's how so many people reacted to this particular medication, and you feel that you might be that average person. Mm-hmm. And so that helps you make without a doctor's advice. And so in the medical field, I think there's a big push towards personalized medicine and knowing you as an individual rather than the last 10 people who came in here had, this condition. Mm-hmm. Therefore, you must have that too because you get some missing. Mm-hmm. So how does that work when they're trying to use this data for health?
Yeah.
When we'll start to learn more about the person individually, is sort of the key to health improvement rather than the average.
Yeah, I think that people who are active in this field would disagree with your characterization that comparing yourself to all of the data that's coming up from kind of regular users is the process of averaging, and would say instead that actually comparing yourself to the results of randomized controlled trials is averaging, and that by being able to drill down into that massive, messy data set and find not, 100 or 1,000 people who match you, but maybe just a couple. So it's a totally different model of thinking about how you value that as information, right? But that being able to find a couple who match much more closely rather than the very generalized by maybe, say, age and sex, like that is an individualized kind of medical care. If you push that to its logical conclusion, that also includes personal genome sequencing and all these other things that are also seen as part of the roster of the individual personalized medicine, say.
Isn't this suggested treatment based on the fact that this drug works well for a lot of people? Like ibuprofen or something,
that ibuprofen might, but if you have, if you have a less common ailment, say, and you're trying multiple things, I think the model works best for complex health problems, right? Where you've tried something and it didn't work, and you tried something else and it didn't work, and you don't really know why. And there are other people who also have had that experience. They may not be able to explain why, but they can't say what worked for them. That's the level of kind of personalized information that people are finding value in these settings, which is why you can imagine it's really controversial and raises a lot of concerns for a lot of scientists who see that as not really valid. Yeah.
Could you comment on the difference you see in the US in terms of privacy laws and attitudes and what you see in Europe, for example?
Yeah, so this is interesting, and I should have said that our focus, we did this research in the US, and I think being specific about the context is really important because these policies are often nationally specific or regionally specific. So, you know, it's funny, in Europe, I have talked to a number of medical doctors as well as people in the kind of health technology startup community, and they bemoan the restrictions in Europe and see the kind of policies around protecting privacy as inhibiting innovation in this sector. And they see the US's openness as really appealing in that way. So in Europe, you know, the right to be forgotten, for instance, is all of these policies in place that make it much harder for companies to do the kinds of things that I was talking about here. So it's not impossible by any means, but the overall discourse is much more protective there. And it prioritizes much more individual autonomy and agency in being able to decide what you want shared and with whom. And so depending on your position in that context, you might see that as highly desirable or as really restrictive and in a kind of destructive way. Yeah,
Kirsten, thanks for a great talk. I'm curious, you know, listening to you talk about privacy and this amazingly global porous public, are we getting a different model of public-private emerging here, or is this an exacerbation of kind of the way we've thought about, you know, those spheres and privacy over time in various disciplines? I'd love to hear your thoughts on that.
So I think that there is a redefinition of those terms that's happening, definitely, and it's fascinating to look at where the pressure points are that really force the definition that either clings to kind of older models or tries to push in a different direction. And that's exactly why, you know, I went to the trouble to say what we thought a traditional medical context was or what happens outside of that and how you characterize those differences. Because when you look at just the wearable phenomenon and how many people are enticed to use these devices for all kinds of reasons and share the data that they get from them, it doesn't line up at all with the ways that we think about how the sort of sanctity of personal health information, right, as a good that should be protected over all other things. Because you talk to patients who are kind of activists around wanting to try new approaches to their care as well as wanting to have different kinds of relationships with providers, and they often say, you know, I don't care who sees my data. I want to be able to freely share data. They're very much of the sort of data liberation mentality, right? Like, data should be free, data wants to be free. Like, that's a thing that's often said in these settings, and that if data is free, it will accomplish all these things that will, among other things, change the ways that we think about who has power and who doesn't, because it's sort of data sort of equated to kind of information and power in that context. And so for those people, the idea that there is a public and a private is very outdated, and it prevents certain kinds of new relationships from being enacted that they see as desirable for all kinds of reasons. When you bring things like either policy on the one hand or money into the discussion, then the conversation changes a lot, because the question of who pays for these devices, who pays for healthcare, the role of these devices in healthcare that's covered by insurance, all of these other things, then you get, again, a reassertion of this model, and it's very much antithetical to the idea of openness that some of these groups are espousing. So I think they're kind of competing discourses there that are very uneven in their understanding of what should be public, what should be private, and what the benefits of those distinctions would be. Yeah.
Okay, time for one last question. Suzanne.
Thanks. You mentioned in passing insurance, and so I wanted to tie that to the notion that you've convincingly demonstrated that people don't seem to mind so much about their privacy and all this data being taken away and so forth, even in their own medical community, so their own clinic or whatever. But once you bring insurance into the picture, don't people start to do a double take and think a little bit about what happens if their clinic results of all sorts of things become accessible to their insurance company, or their Fitbit data for that matter. But once insurance is in there, you have that monetization, and people could be very affected in a very real way by an insurance company deciding, like, given if we might not have the assurance that pre-existing conditions aren't going to matter, if we don't have that insurance, then we could have a pre-existing condition, and then it's going to double our insurance costs. Mm-hmm. So are people starting to become a little bit aware of the connection of insurance with their medical data, and is that concerning them? So that that result that you had might be affected by that. So they might be a little bit more wary of giving up all their patient data or their Fitbit data.
Yeah. Well, it's certainly true that one place where this kind of dialogue has become, it's really been highlighted, the internal contradictions, is in workplace wellness programs that try to use wearables to incentivize employees to lose weight or quit smoking or whatever, and to reward them with decreased insurance premiums. There was kind of a flurry of experiments with that a few years ago, which I think have died down because exactly what you're describing came to the fore, because it wasn't so much the insurance company, it was the employer in the place of the insurance company, but the reality, wait, they want me to participate in tracking myself to benefit their bottom line, but ostensibly to benefit me, but it was really clear what the trade-offs were in that situation and how problematic they were. So in terms of insurance, what you're describing is true to an extent. But one thing that I've noticed, not so much in our interviews, but in my research in this field in general, is that a lot of the people that are kind of at the forefront of this movement have already tried everything they could through traditional means, including insurance, right? And not received the results that they were searching for. And so they almost feel like there's something to lose by pursuing this strategy, even if it exposes certain kinds of information, which, in their view, has been exposed already within their medical records, which the insurance companies have access to in order to pay the bills. So, you know, I think the argument you would hear if you posed this question to people who are kind of really active in this world, it would be that we need to ensure that there is a boundary between, you know, what kinds of medical care you receive and what kinds of data you share and what conditions are covered, just period, right, regardless of anything else that's going on. But the other thing I just want to emphasize is that the draw of participatory culture is really huge and kind of defining in the world that we are living in today. And that has all kinds of implications. But one implication of it is that people, and I don't mean people like who don't think about this, I mean everyone in this room, as well as people outside of this room, see the kind of desirability of participating in those networks often as just being greater than the risk. So both of those things are happening.
Thank you very much, Kirsten.
Thanks.